One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine.
Guys!
In a row?
Welcome to Nine Guys Dynasty Football. I am Jamie G. Esquire, the fifth, master of the Macarena. I'm here with Magnum Mills to talk about nine Dynasty trades in a row.
I was wondering, you were coming in a little hot there, but you were doing the Macarena, so it all makes sense now. And like the man said, I am Magnum Mills. Thanks for checking out Nine Guys, presented by Seize the Gap Fantasy Football. Find us wherever you get your pods by searching for Seize the Gap. Find us on social media at Seize the Gap FF. Our YouTube channel is at JoeBlowFootballShow.com. If you could, please take 8.5 seconds to comment, rate, like, follow, subscribe. Just do one of those things. Like I said, less than 9 seconds. Helps us out a lot. Helps people find the show. We really and truly appreciate it. Thank you.
And that was math by Magnum Mills. 9 seconds, less than. Cue the Daft Punk, because one more time, we're going to look back on some FFPC Dynasty trades Magnum Mills made this past season. Mills, you know what's coming next, right?
Unfortunately, yeah, I think I know what's coming next. To be honest here, I was way too magnanimous when I agreed to leave out the trades where I obviously won the deal, but I said, go ahead, include my obvious trade losses. At the time, I'm like, you know, there's a lot more that we can learn from the bad trades than the good trades or obvious wins. But now that it's actually time, I kind of feel like Shooter McGavin, after his round, he finally has to go back to the parking lot and he knows who's waiting for him.
You eat pieces of shit for breakfast? Gross. Before we start, is there anything that people should know about FFPC Dynasty format that's unique or different from other Dynasty formats?
Short and easy version is definitely a more shallow format. You have to cut down to 14 position players in the offseason, and all scoring is tight end premium. So every players at every position except tight end get 1 point per reception. Players at tight end get 1.5 points per reception. That's pretty much it.
Now that we got all that sorted and out of the way, here's the first deal. February 4th, in a one quarterback tight end premium dynasty league, you, Magnum Mills, you traded away Michael Thomas, Kadarius Toney, and Chris Olave for Javonte Williams. You had to know this was coming. Just what the hell were you thinking here? Give us the thought process.
I mean, there wasn't any, technically at the time, it was the 1.05, it became Chris Olave. I mean, this was a team, it was built around a ton of veterans. I won a couple championships with a core that was primarily Alvin Kamara, Michael Thomas. So, you know, I was like, all right, you got to start somewhere. And at that point, Michael Thomas had barely played. I still don't mind coming off of him. Kadarius Toney is still more theoretical than actual. Maybe those guys were each worth like a second round pick or something like that. So in my mind, I traded Olave in 2 seconds for Javonte Williams. That is still not good, but at least it doesn't look as bad and sound as bad as it does when you all lay it out that way. And this was just a deal when you're trying to find the next big thing, right? And I was convinced Denver was going to make a big move for a quarterback, which they did, and that they were going to maybe have to use more of a one running back system, which ultimately happened, and that Javonte Williams was kind of going to be the next big breakout and be like a top three dynasty running back. If that was the case, the cost would have been worth it. Unfortunately, I had some parts right, but not kind of, you know, the important parts.
The second trade went down on March 30th in a tight end premium dynasty league. You traded away Amon-Ra St. Brown and Amari Cooper for DK Metcalf. This isn't a clear loss like the last deal we just broke down, but I don't know that there's much difference in the dynasty value between St. Brown and Metcalf. How do you feel at this one, you know, about this one looking back almost a year later?
This ties back into the couple of the past episodes we've done on this where I pretty much decided, like, look, I'm going to take Amari Cooper where I have him in non-best ball leagues, and I am just going to get rid of him. And again, Cooper had a nice year, had 9 touchdowns, but still incredibly inconsistent, and I think that's just who he is. There's nothing wrong with that. I was just trying to find people who still maybe thought Amari Cooper had, you know, more kind of name value than he actually had in, you know, real life fantasy value as far as points scored. And this is also a league where I had TJ Hockenson, and you kind of didn't know what was going on with the Lions. I'm like, all right, do I really want to be starting 2 Detroit Lions every week? So I didn't think it was a bad thing to, you know, kind of try to diversify there, so to speak, and just not be over invested in the Detroit offense. You know, as we look at it now, when I do my rankings, I will have Metcalf ahead of St. Brown, but I would expect them to be in the same tier. But if you kind of look at it in a way, like Amari Cooper's probably worth a random second right now. So if you traded Amon-Ra St. Brown in a second for DK Metcalf, doesn't look that bad, and especially after you saw the real kind of dominant performance by Metcalf against the 49ers in the playoffs. You have to be pretty excited. You know, I really like St. Brown, but he's not really a prototypical, you know, wide receiver one. He's more of a Keenan Allen type. Nothing wrong with that, but DK Metcalf still has the potential to rip off like just an amazing like wide receiver one overall season if it all comes together at some point.
If you guys thought that first Javonte Williams trade was bad, just wait till you get a load of trade number three here. It's a doozy. In a super flex tight end premium best ball dynasty league, you traded away Nick Chubb, Amon-Ra St. Brown, David Njoku, and Corey Davis for Javonte Williams, KJ Osborne, Kenny Galladay, Hassan Haskins, and Van Jefferson. I'm kind of surprised that you didn't throw in a kidney while you're at it here. I mean, maybe he didn't ask for one or something, right? I mean, that's got to be it.
Yes. To paraphrase Dr. Zoidberg, this was bad, and I feel bad. My only minor defense here is that this is a league where I believe I had 25 players, and I had to cut down to 16. So I was in a bad spot. I was trying to do some kind of consolidation trade, and I did actually manage to flip Osborne and Galladay for like more mid-round picks. But yeah, dude, this was bad. I really still stand by. If I didn't know there was going to be an injury, I still think Chubb for Javonte Williams is a pretty solid deal. Chubb was great this year, but he's still not getting the full work, barely getting any work in the passing game, just completely dependent on yards and touchdowns, and he's getting towards the age cliff. I don't hate that. Then you add a name around St. Brown, and that's bad. You throw David Njoku on top of that, and it's a fucking travesty. And that's really a lesson I think you can learn here, is be careful when you're going to cross the stream, so to speak. Like, I was trying to accomplish multiple objectives here. Trade Chubb away, you know, again, like I gave the reasons. And I wanted to trade Njoku away because I've been picking him up in every league for about the last year and a half. And I mean, like, I own him in, like, 85-90% of my dynasty league, so I was simply trying to diversify there, and I was trying to add Javonte Williams. As I explained earlier, I thought he could really blow up as a top three dynasty running back, and here you kind of had all of those things come together, and it blinded me a little bit to the fact that I was just giving away way too much, and that the only way this could possibly come close to paying off is if one of the players I traded got hurt and Javonte Williams went nuts. Instead, unlike the system that worked for George Costanza, I got the opposite, and it did not work for me.
That was just epically bad, my man.
It was real bad, dude. That dude didn't even manage to win the league. I gave him, like, he probably would have been in, like, eighth or ninth place if he finished third in the league, basically based on the trade I gave him. So you're welcome, team name who I'm redacting here.
The fourth trade involves some of the same players, some of the same characters, but I think you'll like this one even better. This trade happened on August 31st in a Superflex tight end premium best ball dynasty league. You traded away David Njoku again, DJ Shark, Hunter Renfrow, and Zach Moss for Amon-Ra St. Brown, Tyler Batty, and Jacob Harris. Walk us through this one, and why was it Batty?
This wasn't Batty. This was much, much better than the previous trade. And this is completely a consolidation trade. This is, again, a spot where I had to open up some roster spots. I don't remember the specifics, but it was bad. I was going to have to at least cut Zach Moss for sure, probably DJ Chark on top of that. Definitely in a bad spot. And again, I'm very happy with David Njoku as a player. I've been standing it for years. It's happening, but I own him, again, literally in every single league. In another league, I believe I had Hockenson and Goddard here, so at best he was my tight end three. Didn't mind throwing him in there. And at this point, remember back when like Hunter Renfrow had actual value? Like, I think only you and me in Pepperidge Farms remember. But again, this is a pretty solid deal, all things considered. I think in a vacuum, you know, Njoku for St. Brown would, you know, be a little bit of a steal for me for getting St. Brown. But again, I didn't really have to throw in that much else. DJ Chark got hurt. Zach Moss got traded to the Colts. I don't think he kept him, though, unfortunately. And Hunter Renfrow also hurt. pretty much a total zero this year. But I get why the other guy did it, to let me defend his side a little bit. Theoretically, this was a challenge trade because you were trading one Lions wide receiver for another. If DJ Chark had stayed healthy the whole season, I think the difference between St. Brown and Chark is not the value of David Njoku and Hunter Renfrow. So I definitely think there's a universe where this trade would have worked out for, you know, maybe me and the other guy, because our teams had different needs. And I just do think it is hysterical because I didn't like go out and be like, oh, I've been selling St. Brown, let me buy some more or anything. I just needed to make a consolidation trade. And I even own Hockenson here, which was the reason I moved St. Brown in a different league. But I was just trying to find a trade that would open up some roster spots and work for me. It seemed like a good option. I made the trade. Dude didn't even counter. So I think the lesson here is don't, you know, kind of limit yourself to, I want a specific player. It's always important to look at the other team's rosters and try to figure out a deal that will help both teams, or at least accomplish the goals of both teams on the surface.
In our fifth deal, which went down on March 12th, in a Superflex tight end premium league, you traded away Mike Williams, Big Mike, Davis Mills, and his Adam's apple, and the 2023 3.02 for DK Metcalf and the 2023 4.08. This is the second deal where you acquired Metcalf. Were you actively targeting him in trades, or was it just kind of the way it shook out?
A little of column A, a little of column B. I wasn't going out and actively like being like, all right, you know, sometimes you go in the league, like, all right, I'm going to find every team in the league that has him on the roster and make an offer. Didn't work out that way, but you had teams that were actively trying to sell him because of the Russell Wilson trade, and I was willing to buy low in that case. And now it's pretty easy, like you make your Davis Mills Adams apple joke. But back then, like, there was still a chance he could actually turn into like one of the better quarterbacks from that whole draft class, be at least some kind of a starter or whatever. Of course, there was also a chance that Houston was going to take a quarterback in the draft, which is why I was willing to move on from him. But the real lesson here is something that the other team did well, and that's always ask for a third round pick when you're making a trade. We did this kind of in Monopoly in college. We called it the go money rule. And pretty much was, when you're playing Monopoly and you're making, you know, you're wheeling deal and you're making trades, anytime you make a trade, you also ask for the player's go money the next time around the board. Like 90% of the time, they would just do it. And you always ask for the go money next time around because it's not even money they have yet. Way easier for somebody psychologically to give up on something like that. And they don't want to blow up the whole deal over money they don't even have yet. Exact same concept here. Dude originally asked for my third, and I'm like, no, I'm not going to do that. So I counted out, like, I'll give you a fifth and a sixth. He's like, no, all right, I'll give you a fourth. Nope. So then it came down, all right, I'll throw in a third, and he got his fourth in there. But my third wound up being a lot earlier than I thought it was. So credit him. I think I probably could have waited him out and eventually got the deal done without that, but that's why you always ask for a third. Talked about him before, like Mike Williams, 28 years old, just don't think he can stay healthy. So I've moved all my shares at this point. And, you know, having the early pick there looks a little bit misleading. Like, I should have known better. This was a very good team that got extremely unlucky. Never dreamt I would pick that early. And I've also mentioned that before. There's a reason you want to kind of trade for someone else's draft picks early in the season, early in the off season, because they don't know how good they're going to be yet. And you can occasionally get a team to think they're trading away a late first, and it's an early first. And just to, you know, being one of those things where just everything went wrong, I actually had the 101 here off some Jamar Chase points or whatever. The Joe Burrow points on the Bills game. And then when they rewound the game and gave them all zero, I went from the 101 to the 102. So.
It's a hard knock life. Number six is an interesting deal. On March 29th, in a 1QB tight end premium dynasty league, you, good sir, traded away Ramondre Stevenson, Trey McBride, and Tyquan I Need a Sandwich Thornton for George Pickens in the 2023 3.10. So the 10th pick in the third round. Break this one down for us, man.
At the time, this was pre-rookie draft, so the actual deal was, I believe, Stevenson, the 205 and the 405 for the 111 and a 2023 third. At this point, Stevenson was my RB5, and I had an extremely solid running back core, and I was also very worried about what his season was going to look like. I really pictured a split with Damian Harris here, was worried they would bring a third running back into the mix, a la James White. I mean, this was early enough, I don't even think James White had retired yet. And we did see Stevenson, he did it. He got that big role in the passing game. But at the end of the season, Damian Harris got healthy. And sure as shit, Stevenson kind of really laid a couple of duds down the stretch there. So I don't think I was totally wrong on that idea. Just kind of got lucky or unlucky, depending on which way you want to look at it, with the Damian Harris injury. But what I was really trying to accomplish here in moving up from 205 to 111 was get a good young difference maker at wide receiver. I did not think I would get one of those at 205. And I want to say, in my defense, the team there drafted Trey McBride, wound up cutting him. So I really don't have any regrets about moving up from that 205. And I'm a big George Pickens fan, so I think that's going to work. I think Pickens has more value than Stevenson, at least as of now. And I think it probably stays that way. And another thing you talk about here, if you're sitting on the clock, you feel good, and someone trying to make a trade to move up or even before the draft, don't be afraid to just ask for a lot. Sometimes people are just determined to move up, and even if you don't really want to move back, if you ask for something stupid and they're willing to do it, then you do it, man. There's a reason it's kind of like a Godfather offer or whatever. So even if you have it in your head, you have a tier, like I have pick seven. I have seven guys in the first two tiers, so I want to pick here. If someone is willing to pay a ton of money to drop back a couple picks or something like that, and by money, I mean assets or whatever, or actual money. I don't know what kind of league you play in, but yeah. So just never say no. You know what I mean? Again, another kind of like always just yes. Just say yes. Another George Costanza thing, right? Just say yes. Say yes to everything. Not to everything, but a lot of things.
Say yes, and it, dude, it doesn't hurt to ask. The worst you can get is a no, and if you want to play this game, you better be used to hearing no a lot. Number seven's just a little guy here, just a little itty bitty guy. On September 3rd, in a Superflex tight end premium best ball dynasty league, you traded away Sam Howell for Greg Dulcich and Matt Corral. How do you feel about this one now that Howell has been named the potential and probable, I think, starting quarterback for the Commanders next year?
Don't worry, Jamie G. You won't be small forever. I mean, how do I really feel about this? Like, could he potentially be the starting quarterback? Yeah, just like Uncle June could potentially have gotten with Ange Dickinson, right? I mean, maybe we'll just see who gets lucky first. But seriously, did like Howell a lot coming out of North Carolina. There were a lot of people who argued he had the best raw tools in the entire draft. Looked pretty good in his one game of action there in week 18. I definitely think there's a lot to like, but I also think they're definitely not going to just like hand him the starting job. You're going to get something at least more than the Texans did with Davis Mills. They're going to bring in someone at least semi-credible, whether that's another rookie, a guy like, I don't know, maybe that's where Matt Ryan ends up. Who knows, you know, but I think they'll at least bring someone in there to compete with him. But from a logistical standpoint, this was a pure roster space move. Dulcich and Cora were both IR eligible at the time. So I effectively opened up three roster spots with this deal, which was huge because I was probably going to have to cut Howell anyways. So theoretically, I got both of these guys for a guy I was probably going to have to cut. So not too bad. And, you know, I don't want to totally discount Corral. He was, the Panthers moved up for him in the third round. Even with a new kind of regime coming in, I think he at least gets a shot to compete for the starting job next year, whether it's, you know, kind of a token chance or a real chance. And Dulcich looks like, you know, maybe a top 12, top 14 dynasty tight end. So definitely happy with it. But, you know, Howell has to turn into a superstar for me to feel bad about this one, I think.
So stay tuned. I guess you weren't lying when you said that you had David Njoku in literally every league. At number eight, our eighth deal to discuss here, we have a deal that went down on September 29th in a 1QB tight end premium dynasty league. You traded away, once again, David Njoku and Clyde Edwards-Helaire for Nico Collins, of all people, Kate Otten. It's getting Otten in here. And the 2023 1.09. You're happy with this one, right? You got to be.
It's getting Otten here. You can never get that one right. You always add the too much. It's getting Otten here. I mean, seriously.
It's getting Otten here.
It's just getting Otten here. Yeah, it's just getting Otten here. That's the, his name is set up for it. I mean, it's the man's name. It's, you know, it's the man's name. In a vacuum, I don't think I can get the 109 for Njoku. I think you could probably get in tight end premium an early second for him. I don't think you're getting the 109 and you're basically not getting anything for Clyde Edwards-Helaire at this point. So, yeah, I'm happy with that. Happy to have just gotten anything for Clyde Edwards-Helaire, basically. I do like the potential of Nico Collins. I'm pretty sure they'll move on from Brandon Cooks. Even if they draft a wide receiver, I don't think they're going to spend big money on one. So I think he has one more chance to maybe step into a nice role. He did not do himself any favors with his injuries last year. And I want to say the guy I made this deal with flamed out in the playoffs, and he's already sold his team. And, you know, I want to think I kind of drove him there because he traded, you know, wasn't a first-round pick just for Clyde Edwards-Helaire. But on a level, you could say he traded a first-round pick for Clyde Edwards-Helaire. So I think I broke him.
And honestly, you won here because, let's just be honest, you wanted to get rid of Clyde Edwards-Helaire. And for our final deal, I'll let you feel a little bit better about yourself here, Magnum Mills. You've been beaten up tonight. You've taken them like a champ. On March 12th, in a Superflex Tight End Premium Dynasty League, you dealt away your guy, Kenneth Gainwell. Mecole Hardman, who you've been hoping has become a thing, would become a thing for years and years and years. Tyrion Davis Price, all for Ramondre Stevenson and Calvin Austin. What was the breakdown on this one?
Yeah, this was another pre-draft trade, I think. So it was technically Gainwell, Hardman in the 309 for Stevenson in the 702. Calvin Austin really didn't become anything, wound up not playing this year for the Steelers. Fourth round pick out of Memphis, I believe, wide receiver. Decent stash, but I believe I even had to cut him. I ran out of IR spots. It was that kind of year. And this is, again, before cut down. So Gainwell and Hardman were both literally on the line. I think I would have had to cut one of them. And as you mentioned, I do really like Gainwell's talent. Very, very excited about him as a rookie in the rookie drafts and everything. But given the way they've used him this year, I think even if they let Sanders walk, he's probably destined to be in a running back by committee. So I think that really relegates him to best ball leagues or as a handcuff in your season-long leagues. Interior David Price, congratulations. You're the new Trey Sermon, your third-round running back by the 49ers, who will go into next year. If best case scenario is you're going to be the RB3. My guess is the 49ers draft yet another running back in the third round, because why not? They do it every year, and then they'll find a different running back who goes ahead of you. And actually, Jordan Mason might be already ahead of you, undrafted rookie. So you're probably not going to happen, dude, unless you could trade it to the hope for that trade to the Dolphins, I guess, TDP. That's what needs to happen for you.
Those were nine dynasty trades in a row. And this was Nine Guys Dynasty presented by Seize the Gap Fantasy Football. Thank you for listening and or watching. We greatly appreciate you. If you could, go ahead and take the second or seconds it may take to like this YouTube video or rate the podcast wherever you are listening. Helps other people find our show. We greatly appreciate it. Y'all appreciate it. Magnum Mills, did I miss anything?
You just kind of crossed over Dear Mama with a pirate when you were like, y'all appreciate it. I have not really heard a Tupac pirate mashup, so very excited about where we could go with that one. Just got to tell everyone you find us wherever you get your pods by searching for Seize the Gap on the social medias at Seize the Gap FF. And you can find our YouTube channel at JoeBlowFootballShow.com. I am Magnum Mills. He's Jamie G. And that was nine trades in a row.
We're getting closer to shifting to that 2023 mode. We're going to do a couple more episodes wrapping up 2022 and then move into 2023 right around the Super Bowl. We'll see you then.